So the game we're going to be talking about is Thomas Was Alone. I do this every day. How many people in the room haven't heard of Thomas Was Alone? Awesome. Actually, it's quite low. That's cool. Awesome.
Well, we said yesterday, but...
Right. So you weren't paying attention for the... Awesome. So Thomas Was Alone is an indie platformer, a bunch of different characters, use them together to do things. And it has a voiceover, and kind of a story that goes through it. So today we're going to be talking about the writing of the game, and I'm going to be collecting lots of awesome feedback. Joining me are the immensely awesome Antony Johnston, who Daredevil, Wasteland, comics, video games like Dead Space, and Kieron Gillen, who I've never heard of. I don't like. There was Rock Paper Shotgun. My girlfriend actually exclaimed. She made an exclamation sound when she heard I was talking to Kieron because she's a massive X-Men fan. But yeah, equally awesome. So what I'm going to do, just to kind of frame this, I'm going to put up a very quick trailer for Thomas Was Alone, and we'll take it from there. If it works. Oh, I'm going to wait for the image to come up.
Hey.
So that hopefully kind of introduces what the game is. As you saw there's a voiceover that's basically told a narration throughout the game by the awesome Danny Wallace, who was absolutely joy to work with. And yeah, it kind of tells a story of a series of characters meeting, becoming friends, going on an adventure, and kind of extrapolates out from there. So I guess the first question to start with is, what did you guys think of Thomas Was Alone? It's a very dangerous question.
No, I enjoyed it. Yeah, I mean, do you want to get into specifics?
Let's do it. Specifics. Let's go.
It started a bit too slow, which you've already acknowledged.
Yes.
Yeah, it started a bit slow, but what I did like was how the simple addition of the voiceover and the sort of narrative conceit injected personality into what are essentially just like rectangles.
Where did that come from? I mean, what's your...
I was going to ask, because mechanics presumably came first.
I mean, how did that develop?
The short version is it was basically a kind of a game jam game, like 24-hour thing. I thought it would be interesting to have two characters that you could control. One could jump higher. I just thought there was some interesting stuff to do. It was like a 30 level, about 10 minutes. Absolutely awful. I've deleted it off the internet. but it's the internet, so it's still there if you want it.
Nothing dies on the internet.
Nothing dies on the internet. With no story, just basically had Thomas Was Alone at the start because I thought, you know, a game where a character makes friends, that's a nice way to start it. It's just the simplest journey in the world. And then that kind of did well, so I decided to extrapolate it through. And honestly, the mechanics and the kind of character traits came up together. So it was a case of... So the reason they're rectangles started off because, you know, it was easy. But then as it went on, it became very obvious. I tried to pin these new art styles on that actually a rectangle is the best possible art for that because you can tell where the collision falls. So if I made that a cube character, right, it might become confusing as to where the extents were. You know, capsule collisions would have...
There's no ambiguity about the
collision. There's no ambiguity. Yeah. It's that kind of... It's the way I think gamers see games. You're not running around in Gears of War. You're not seeing the cement wall. You're seeing the extent of where that prevents cover and stuff like that. The development of the characters and the story kind of came together at the same time, and it was a case of, you know, a character... What would a character whose ability was entirely selfless feel like? So that's where Laura, who's bouncy and makes other characters jump high, feels used because she never does anything of her own. A character like Claire, who is kind of useless, except in the specific case of floating in water, starts insecure and then feels like feels powerful and like a superhero. So it's kind of, they kind of grew together, I think, to answer your question, I think. So yes, anyway. Kieron.
Sorry, I'm not being ignorant, by the way. All my notes are on my phone.
Awesome.
This is like the sort of it's a specific take, as in, you know, voiceover over relatively simple. That is the most obvious thing about the game, which people will talk, oh, it's the one with the voiceover and the blocks.
Yeah.
So why voice? That's what I mean. Is why voiceover and blocks? Were you think? I mean, obviously, Bastion is probably the one in the most recent times that used that technique. Did you have it before Bastion, or was it that's interesting?
It was actually.
Or was it a bit Portal even?
It was laziness. Portal comes up a lot because Stephen Merchant and Danny have a similar accent.
I thought it was somebody doing an impression. Steve Merchant at first.
and in fairness, you're not alone. No, Danny is like a TV presenter and writer.
Danny Wallace, but I didn't realise that at first.
Yeah, and I think Portal 2 definitely was a reference. Bastion, Yes, because it was so awesome, but probably less directly. Honestly, the main reason, anyone who played it at GameCity last year, because I'm a graphic design kind of geek, it started off with like motion typography. So you'd be running through the level and text would come up telling you the story. And that was the version actually that was at GameCity last year. And that exists, there's some videos of that online. But about 4 months before I was planning to release, I realized just how much work it is to create essentially 100 bespoke motion graphics. It wasn't working. The other thing was I knew the writing was being constrained by that because I was specifically writing shorter sentences because I knew it would take me less time. Mm-hmm. And when I was there, I was thinking that's the point where I thought this isn't actually serving the work. So voiceover felt natural, presenting it in a nice way. At that point, I started because I've never written anything before. I kind of was thinking, well, what do I know that I like? And I like Danny's work, his audiobook specifically. So I kind of sat down and started writing kind of in his voice, then spent about a month trying to find a voiceover actor who could do an impression of Danny Wallace, then got drunk and emailed Danny Wallace, found his email on some fan stalker site, and then stalked him. And amazingly, he's a gamer. He used to write for PC Gamer way, way back. And he just kind of went for it and we took it from there. So it was kind of, there was a utility to it. It was the best solution given the kind of the time and the money and the limitations I had on me. Because obviously I also have a day job, so this is a weekends and evenings thing. So it was just about working that out. So that was the main reason. But then obviously trying to capitalize on what a voiceover gives you in terms of, you know, being able to identify with a character at a time, for example, get, you know, we at no point do we say, you know, Chris is a dickhead. We have Chris narrating for a moment, and you see, hopefully, that works.
But he's a dickhead, yeah.
Poor Chris. That's poor Chris. I feel sorry for him.
That's interesting, actually, because
a lot of people love Chris, actually. It's weird. It's a very, he's a divisive character.
My background is originally in graphic design, and one of the things I liked about the game was just how well it was designed and the typography. I had no idea that
I did it for, that was my job for, I think, for about a year. I did working within the games industry, but I did pitch documentation. I did the graphic design for it.
Oh, okay.
Taken under the wing of a really cool graphic designer called Paul Jennings, who just kind of basically gave me a crash course in about 3 months of, you know, this is how you line things up. And, you know, and the color palette actually was done by a concept artist friend. That was the side of it that I really kind of, I'd say actually I probably devoted more time to the color and scale of the rectangles than I probably did to the writing, in all honesty, writing. It came later in the day. It was written over a weekend, I think, actually. So
the pacing of the opening, I mean, it was a bit slow, but the pacing story-wise was interesting as well. One of the notes I've made here is that it's called Thomas Was Alone, but he acquires friends really quickly.
It seems
like too much time was spent making in the centre of everything, only for him to then be rapidly shunted off, because he also just disappears quickly.
Spoilers.
Yes.
Well, come on, I mean.
Yeah, no, you're absolutely right.
But what I find interesting about that is there is a common problem in fiction writing, and Kieron will know all about this as well, the minor character who takes over. You have your main character, and then you introduce a minor character who's got like a cool quirk or something, and suddenly you become enamored of this minor character, and they just kind of take over, and suddenly they become more important than the main character.
Yeah.
And that's something you really have to watch and guard against, isn't it, in general fiction. And it seemed like this was almost like the video game equivalent.
It was. I ran away, but basically, yeah, so apologies to all of you. Please play the game, but I am about to ruin it.
Spoilers.
So yes, so if you're watching the video, fast forward a bit. Essentially, yeah, you have this kind of cast of characters, and this is probably the thing about the story that's most complained about. It's interesting, fans absolutely have the same opinion as you, is that at a certain point in the game, I kill off the entire cast, including Thomas.
Well, that I actually didn't have a problem with.
You didn't mind that?
No, I quite liked
that. Oh, it was before that. He gets kidnapped earlier on.
Yeah, the fact that Thomas just disappears quite much earlier than that.
He does.
There's all these other characters. And you're just like, well, hang on, wasn't this game supposed to be about him?
I think it's as you say, it's a symptom basically of the game design at that point, the game designer brain taking over from the writing. And it's the same reason that friends are introduced so quickly is because, someone's just tweeted me, because the game design objectified the other characters.
Yeah.
Honestly, looking back, I would have had a second character introduced on the second level. But from a writing point of view, I totally get what you're saying. Yeah. Yeah, and exactly the same with the last levels of the game. And in fact, actually, the very last end of the game, the last 20 levels of the game take place with the cast of characters who are completely different from the rest of the game.
Right.
Which looking back, was a big mistake, I think. Because people fell in love with those first few characters, and then I removed them. Would you disagree?
No, I don't think so. I don't think it was a mistake. I think, I was going to come to this later, I think the ending was mishandled. Hmm. I didn't have a problem with killing off those characters and the theme of self-sacrifice and all that. But the fact that they literally were just never seen again. Yeah. I would have liked to have seen a kind of like a slightly poetic
kind
return.
Of an Obi-Wan moment where you see
right, exactly,
kind of,
yeah.
I know exactly what you mean. Yeah.
Yeah. Sorry, go on, I'm dominating this. Go on,
No. It's you've also played more of it than I have, so it's a kind of bit more interesting. You actually act weirdly, Thomas is the lead character, you say. The only reason Thomas is the lead character is the title. And this is actually the piece of writing which is almost in every... It's the piece of writing that's in all games. The title that this is something I said like yesterday on stage was Space Invaders is one of the best pieces of writing of all time because it's called Space Invaders. Mm. Without calling it Space Invaders, the game is meaningless. Mm. It's the game about aliens in space invading, and that, they're coming at you. There's implication this might not be good. They don't look friendly. Mm. They're destroying your buildings. But so what you call the you wouldn't have the problem of Thomas being the lead character if it's called Ensemble Clashed of Blocks.
Yeah,
only Thomas is alone. That makes it. That narrative problem. Yeah. As in if you just, block chums, which is an awful title. You know.
Let's write that down.
Yeah, a block chum. Yeah.
It's really
Thomas Alone 2, block chums.
Well, I can never.
But that title also wouldn't have gone with the feel of the game.
Yeah, exactly. That's the
atmosphere of the game.
It's interesting because it's actually the game grew out of that. Also, I can never do Thomas Was Alone 2 because of the acronym. Which is unfortunate. Reddit worked that out within about 20 minutes of an AMA. They did screenshots, they did logos. I love the cycle in the room of people working it out and
yeah,
not
yeah, yeah.
The story was interesting because obviously when it was a Flash game, it didn't have a story. It was characters jumping on top. And I was sat in a Mexican restaurant with a friend talking about the game, and obviously it needed a name, and things like block chums were on the table. and we were talking, like, what should we call it? And this is a moment of terrible honesty, said, well, we should call it something kind of a bit moody and a bit interesting, because then it will be it will be perceived as cooler than it is, because it's just rectangles. And I said, like, it should be emotive, so I don't know, Thomas, and he makes friends, so Alone, because then he can have that journey. What was really interesting and what taught me a lot about game writing was that the names for all the feedback, all the kind of people talking about the game that were talking about the story and the emotions that it evoked, the red one was Thomas because he's the first one. And it was really interesting that even just with the title, it's exactly what you're saying, that established the red one is Thomas and therefore because he's the first character.
Yeah.
And it was that kind of, and people started putting on the personality. So people thought the yellow one was cantankerous. Because he was useless and couldn't jump as high. People were saying, I had one person who thought it was entirely a metaphor for Seinfeld. Like someone thought the characters all aligned with Seinfeld. And when this stuff started developing, that was the point where I thought, okay, I should have probably actually invest some time in working this out.
Yeah.
But yeah. Cool.
Go on, will you?
I was about to say, the thing I wouldn't say most like about game, but I think it's a game with a very strong understanding of the mood it wants to create. And that's what the title does create. As you say, you know, it's perfect for the game. Everything is aesthetically aligned in an impressive way, in an absolute minimum number of elements and creates an enormous effect from. And that's good writing, as you know, whatever writing means.
Oh, thank you.
And another good bit of praise. there's a level, I think it's around 4.5 or something, where because obviously it's a game, you're desperately trying not to die. You're trying to get through the level in one go without having to restart. Mm. But 4.5, whichever level it is, you have to. Because there's a moving block and you have to die in order to respawn on the other side of the block. You simply cannot get past the
spikes. I've got some terrible news for you, which ruins
the. Are you going to tell me that you
don't have to die? Do you know what's really interesting?
What I was going to say was that I like how that set up the theme of sacrifice like in a few levels later.
Okay,
that works. I'm useless.
That works. Interestingly, the checkpointing is interesting because there were no if you died, the level restarted until about 3 weeks before I released it.
Oh wow!
Because the previews laid into that massive. It was the most frustrating game ever, and I just had to go back. Specifically, actually, Louis' preview was particularly scathing, and I went back and added that in a panic.
Right.
So
well, thank
yeah,
you,
I'll
Louis,
take it.
I would have been tearing my what's left of my hair out.
It was awful, and it's one of those things where, in hindsight, it's just the dumbest decision I made. Well, it wasn't a decision; it was laziness, essentially. So specifically with writing, there's a lot of. I found myself in a position as someone who had never written fiction before. I basically got a couple of books recommended to me, kind of. So I read. I didn't read McKean's. I read Save the Cat, which was written by, I can't remember the name of the writer, but that was one.
Yeah, I can't remember.
It was very hacky. It was written by the writer of Stop or My Mum Will Shoot, which is not a great pedigree necessarily. But it was just a structure, and it didn't matter that it wasn't very good. It seemed like it was something I could work off of. Was that the best approach to just start kind of, because that's my approach to learning anything, is I'll go out and get a couple of books on it and try and start. Would you recommend that to someone starting out? Should people work it out for themselves?
It's not a bad way to approach it. I'm the same. Like, you know, I immediately think research and start reading stuff. It's not a bad way to start out as long as you understand that it's no substitute for actual practice, for doing it.
Sure.
And the only way you actually get better is to do it and then do it again and then do it again. And just, you know, keep practicing, keep getting better. You can read all the books you like, but all that theoretical knowledge won't help until you actually start writing stuff yourself.
Yeah, I only really think... I mean, I would agree with that. I mean, it's always things remember about writers. It's like, James Elroy and Margaret Atwood are both amazing writers, but they fundamentally do different things. And this is kind of like... That's what I think if you get too obsessed by essentially the writing texts, you fail to understand that these are all basically people who have metabolized and created their own rules and voices and fiction. That's kind of what it's about. It's a good place to start. It's as good as any. It's all about essentially how you've then made those rules make sense and how you approach your own work. When I talk, I mean, because I'm a music obsessive, I talk in song structures a lot. Mm. I talk in that kind of synthesis. And that doesn't really make sense to anyone else apart from me, but that's how I think about story. In terms of like contraction and crescendo and that, as in I want to make this one feel like Be My Baby, I want to have that drum beat. And that doesn't mean anything to anyone else, but it still allows me to do what I do. That's what I would say.
So I think it's facilitating thought, right?
Yeah.
It's, if you think about it, it's working out a way to think at a slightly higher level about the structure and the...
Yeah, yeah. It's a launch pad.
You know,
they're all like sort of springboards. Mm. The problem comes when you start thinking that you'll find a magic bullet in a book like that, because there is no magic bullet for anything, not just for, you know, writing stories. As long as you're aware of that and you think, well, okay, this will just give me a bit of a grounding so that, you know, maybe I'll have a little bit of a head start when I start doing my own stuff. But it really is small.
I guess
it's not a bad thing.
It's a lot like game design or graphic design where you have... You learn the rules so you can break them, I guess. You have something to start off from and a framework to... Kieron, sorry, you're about to...
No, I'm trying to remember a quote, and it's really wanky, so I don't want to misattribute it.
That's what we're all about in these panels.
But it's like
wankier the better.
Which
it was about German versus... Talking about theory and art, and the Russian who's the quote, and pretty much, you know, the Germans are very much theory first. They theory, then apply. I mean, like, you know, we make up the theory after we've done it. And it's like kind of the theory is a game which you play after the fact, which is there's a truth there. It's, you know, there's different philosophies. I think many, especially people in games. In fact, we're talking about this in the IF panel. The idea, you know, the idea, there is a set of rules for fiction, and if we follow this, we can actually have a philosophy in input output.
Yeah.
And art tends to be more complicated than that, as in there's so many different rules. And one of the old things I always say about comics is fundamentally whatever works. Yeah. As in, if it breaks the theory, and I apply that to games. As in, the more, when I was younger especially, I had very hard rules about games. And I said, if you did this, you're wrong. In my old age, I've become there. I'm a bit more...
You've mellowed.
Absolutely, like, you know, I'm aware that life is far too complicated. There are so many great games which don't fit in my theory.
Well, and
even games I don't like. And they see me on so much from other people. I mean, I insult Final Fantasy for like the last 15 years, but... Boo. but clearly it works. I mean, it doesn't matter. It defies every single law I like about games. Clearly it works. So
there is no formula.
As a creative, surely you do have to have an opinion. You can't just
That's different.
It's your own stuff.
What I'm saying is, me as a critic versus me as a creator.
Right, okay.
As a creator, I'm a fascist. I've got beliefs how I like world to be. Mm. But as a critic, I think you need to. And also, But also, if you're actually trying to learn off somebody else, by definition, their rules will not be your rules. Yeah. So you have to. It's a double think. How you operate versus how you advise someone should operate.
But you also have to recognise the difference between opinion and facts. Yes. Yeah, and, yeah. You know, saying that there are rules. Well, there aren't really any rules. You know. Mm-hmm. But sometimes it takes a while to realise that. And angry young creators, especially, tend to fall into that trap.
I know as well, though, with game design, I always send out a proviso with any game design documentation I send anyone, which is I never use the word could, would, should, any of that. I will always say this the character does this and like this, and I always say in the proviso, like, I write like that because I want to give you a firm idea of what I'm saying. I'm not saying that that's gospel. Right, it's that kind exactly. of. Yeah. I wouldn't want to read a book where it was, well, you could try this, but I've sometimes found this work. You know, I'm not sure how useful that would be. Yeah. The next question, I guess,
on game reviews, the thing I used to to edit new writers, always too much facilitation wandering around. No, you delete all the maybes.
Yes.
You know, exactly. For God's sake, we're paying for your opinion. Give us an opinion. Yeah.
So with Thomas, it's February this year. I've not got any story. I've got a few levels built. I'm kind of in a good place. I have enough money to pay one of you to write the game. What do you think you would have done differently? And you can change the game design. You can change anything. What would you have done to make this a better story?
Assuming that we're talking about the same basic story, but just sort of tweaking it.
Yeah.
Because otherwise we could have come up with something entirely different. I would have either ditched the mystery about the pixel cloud or expanded on it more.
Okay.
You touched on it, but then you didn't follow through. Mm. That was something that really stood out. It was like, oh, there's going to be a big mystery about the pixel cloud, and then suddenly the just kind of wasn't.
Out yeah. Because, I lost interest, I think, yeah.
And that's mainly the problem. And the thing is, there are others, like there's a few too many characters. Mm. I had real trouble remembering their names. Real trouble remembering all their names. Gray, spoilers again. Gray being a liar and deceptive, and it was just kind of wasted. It didn't actually serve any purpose. There was no consequence to it. Again, no follow through. Most of the criticisms I have are like that, where you came up with interesting ideas, but they didn't
quite
follow them
take
through.
It where they needed
but
to be.
You know, I assume this is the first narrative you'd ever written.
Yes,
so
absolutely.
These are all kind of. And I don't mean this to sound too dismissive, but they're all basically rookie mistakes.
Yeah.
They're all mistakes that we've all made. Mm. And, you know, with practice and experience, you kind of recognise them and go, oh, wait a minute, no, I can't do that.
Yeah.
So there was nothing terribly heinous in there. But yeah, if you were to, hire me or hire Kieron, I'm sure those are the things that we'd
tweak.
Those
are the kind of areas where you would just say kind of more satisfying, I guess.
Right, you either need to double down on this or get rid of it.
Mm. It's a lot. I mean, there's stories of momentum and arcs. So, it begins here, this element becomes... Weirdly, this is the bit that's most, mechanical. And you can sort of sit back. What feels right is one thing, and then what is actually... What shows means it's the arcness. It's basically everything Antony's just said. I mean, I've only played about an hour of it, so I haven't quite got the larger structure. What would I have done?
It's all about payoff.
This is the thing, is I find it very hard to imagine, in terms of the nuts and bolts of it, I find it very hard to imagine it different. And if you actually start from scratch and build again, I would end up a big...
You'd have a different game.
It would be a different game. Yeah, I'd be like a really hardcore political game about Tetris or constructivism or something. Nice. Literally survivors of a Tetris massacre. These are desperately trying to carry on through.
That was totally the subtext here.
I didn't want to say that because you might actually be what happens.
the ending you've not seen. You see, that's like the last scene.
I've done more game projects where I have been brought in to tweak things like that, and so I'm probably a bit more practical-minded than you about it.
We were talking about this yesterday, but the whole if the game fundamentally exists, and it's like you're looking at the playing pieces and trying to work out what story you can tell.
Right.
So I have these dolls.
Right.
Now, what could they do? Can they make out? I don't think they make out. Right. Can they juggle? Yeah, they juggle. Great.
Yeah. That's interesting.
But as I say, the majority of it would just be cleaning things up, and it's all about payoff. You can tell a very very simple story, and it can be extremely satisfying as long as you pace it and build it and pay it off correctly. It doesn't have to be terribly complex.
Sure. I just watched Up at the weekend for the first time by Pixar.
Did you avoid Up for this long?
I'm incredibly useless. So I basically
didn't see it until I was on a plane maybe 18 months ago.
Nice. Cried like a baby for the first 15 minutes.
Man.
But that is the first 15 minutes of the minute. You could actually leave when the when the spoilers, which are on the poster. But you know, when the house actually takes off and leaves, you can actually literally end here because it's all metaphor. You know, this is full on metaphor thing, and that is actually a short film, an incredibly beautiful short film, but a very simple one.
A short film. I think the rest of the film struggles to actually match the beauty of that.
It's incredible.
Utterly amazing.
But yeah, you don't have to tell a complicated story. I mean, that's not to say you can. I tell lots of very complicated stories, but you don't have to. So a lot of the elements that you had in there, I either would have removed or just, you know, sort of tweaked and said, okay, let's make this a focus.
Yeah. The thing is, since it's at heart, it's a very abstract game.
Yes.
This is an abstract platformer. Therefore, what you've done is actually almost kind of magical. It's literally here is a cute block. It's like, and we've given a voiceover, and suddenly these characters.
I think a lot of it occurs within the. I'd love to take credit, but I think so much of it happens in the head of the player. I think we're designed. It's the same reason people see, you know, Jesus's face on crackers.
Right,
well,
right.
Either that or it's Jesus communicating with us.
It's terrible. Don't eat me, for God's sake.
That would be awful. I'm going to feel so stupid. We're designed to see people.
Yeah,
we're designed to
people
see
have
these.
A tendency to anthropomorphize anything, especially if it's given name and a personality.
And as I said, that was a realization I came to with the Flash game, and I just kind of, it felt, I was actually a little bit scared that perhaps I was imposing too much. Like, actually, should I leave this more open for the player? But it felt like it needed it to just keep the momentum really going through the game, because it is quite it's not long, it's about 2 or 3 hours long if you're playing it.
It's
but it needs something.
A bit more than that if you're as crap as me.
But what's great is if you're as crap as you, you see these excellent, awesome story things ahead of time, which is very cool. I get some free story out of it.
What I am interested in is, like, you've got the characters and the theme and the mood and everything, but where did the AI theme come from? The idea that these are, like, you know, newly formed artificial intelligence
I'm not
finding their
name
place
drop,
in the world.
But I got a game designer friend who really took me to task on it. Because essentially what it was pandering. It was me saying, the story I wanted to tell was this kind of the mythic characters, the story of, you know, these archetypes going on an adventure. But I was terrified that there would be a certain kind of player who would come to the game who would go, well, why are there rectangles? Like, why didn't he bother to do artwork? It happened anyway. But the AI thing was an attempt to come up with some kind of naturalistic explanation that would work to explain what was going on. And I also like the AI thing as a... Sorry, to give some context for those who don't know, the game is set inside a computer. The idea is you're watching essentially the emergence of the first self-aware AI is happening. It's an area of sci-fi I'm into. I like the idea of almost making a prequel to every AI based sci-fi ever. I like the idea that this could be Skynet, this could be Data, this could be any kind of those kind of things, which might be a little bit highfalutin thinking about it. It's a little bit pretentious saying that, I apologize. But I liked it, but I don't think I did it well enough to justify it. And I think it was, because it was born of a desire to not look stupid in front of, you know, teenage boys, I think it was perhaps not the best move I made.
You've chosen the wrong medium, haven't you?
I have.
No, I think it worked well, apart from you didn't bring it back at the ending. This comes back to payoff again. There was no, just something as simple as a closing, you added these quotes, supposedly historical quotes from, you know, scientists reminiscing about this, the birth of artificial intelligence throughout, at the start of it. I think it was at the start of every
level.
Major
level. AI human rights 1.0,
2.0, etc. And you didn't have one at the end, and that felt unsatisfying. That was like, that really would have just rounded it off nicely.
And again, it's something I get on Twitter at least a couple of, like, is that the end?
Right.
And that's like the ultimate criticism.
Yeah.
Right? That completely shows.
I mean, it's purely a point of, you know, sort of process, if you like.
Mm.
But yeah, in terms of the narrative, it did lack that kind of closure.
It's like spoiling at the twist end. It's literally a Skynet awakening, and then seen as actually just nuclear war. This is actually very cute. What did you do?
Exactly. You created a monster. it crossed my mind. Like, it crossed my mind to do the really kind of the twist kind of ending, and I reined it in. But
quite often,
something
just
satisfying would have been good, I think.
Yeah. Have you read Greg Egan's Diaspora?
I haven't.
Novel. You should.
No, I should.
I had that in my mind the whole time I was playing the game.
Another one is Flatland, which I never played, which was the 2D characters. I've not read enough in general, I don't think. I'm going to open it up, actually, because there's so many awesome I assume also, I don't know any of you personally, people in the room who I imagine have questions, and you've not had enough opportunities to ask these guys questions yet, so I think we can open it up. Does anyone have any questions about writing? Oh, yes, sir. The man who has not heard of Thomas was alone.
Do we have a roaming mic?
Oh, yep, there's one behind you.
Right.
You hadn't heard of Thomas was alone despite having listened about it for an hour yesterday. Yes, hello. Are you on?
Hang on.
I think they're at the scrambling.
Try now.
Hello.
Hello.
Hey. Hello. All good. I was going to say, as a writer, because everyone's a writer, I can create characters, that's the beginning, and I can put them in a situation, that's the middle, but what's the best way to end it other than it was all a dream, or you kill the big monster?
How long's a piece of string? The ending has to make sense. The ending has to be logical but unexpected.
That's a good way.
Without any more specifics. Every ending must be logical but unexpected.
There was a philosophy,
and that's the same for scenes as well as the overall story.
Very good. There's certainly a philosophy of writing, which is the idea that the big arch plot, this is the ultimate moment in the character's life. The ending speaks the ultimate truth of the character. So for me, I actually know how most of my characters end up when I invent them, because that's why they were invented. Mm. You know, characters that exist to die, whatever die means. And die is when they leave the story fundamentally. So that is what I know. I'm writing, I know the ending. Even if the ending ends up being different, and you hear a lot of people writers saying this, I know where the story's going, because that's, and I know lots of few things along the way, and you go on a little wandering walk, like a fish, like this. Sorry. So that's really, you know, but that is, I would, you say you can create characters, but what are they for? And what are they for normally speaks to the ending. And it's what do they want? Why do they want it? What are they willing to give up to get it? And that's the fundamental things that drive drama.
And also, depending on the sort of story you're telling, characters aren't necessarily the first step. Sometimes the world or the environment or a situation or a problem can be the first step, and then you create characters that will fit in that, what you know, the story that grows out of that situation or problem or world or event.
Occasionally you just get like a really like weird formalist idea, like I want to do a story told entirely in, you know, the second person past tense or something. I want to do like, here, who's a really
a interesting... A nine-panel grid.
Here's a really interesting panel transition I want to do. And then everything else kind of comes from that. And, you know, Alan Moore talks about this. You attack a story in various ways, and then everything else kind of fills in.
But endings are hard, basically. Endings are, without doubt, the hardest part about writing any story. There are so many writers who are really great but don't do very good endings because it's really fucking hard. So, you know, it's... If you think, oh, I shouldn't be struggling with endings so much, well, actually, you should, because every writer does.
I'm actually going to jump. I was going to ask, we'll get more questions in a minute, but I'm going to jump in. So with characters specifically and character voice, that was something I really struggled with, kind of like making a character talk the way. Is it just a case of really knowing your character, you know, obviously taking inspiration from the real world? Like finding that voice and having the character, like with Chris, not having him ever say, oh, I'm a bit cantankerous, actually having that communication taking place. Is that a challenge? Is that something that just you've just never, there's never a point where you're okay with that? It's always going to develop?
I would say so, yes.
I mean, people say quite nice things about my character voices, and I don't think I do good voices at all. Mm-hmm. As in, it's one of the things I really do work on. So the fact I'm not, you know, people don't say all my characters sound the same, that, you know, it's nice, it implies it works out. How do I do that? I don't know, panic and stress. And it's like you read it aloud, it's this character. You know, and you think, what would the character say? Why would they say it?
Reading it aloud isn't always the answer, but it can help.
Yeah.
I wasn't going to admit it, but I will because we're being filmed. But I do a Danny Wallace impression, and that was very useful. sorry, Danny, if you ever see this. I do a Danny Wallace impression, so I felt I could kind of imitate his voice, and I did constantly read it out loud while I was writing it.
Right.
How's that different when you're working with a character who already has a voice? Because obviously both of you have worked on massive, awesome stuff. Like, if a character pre-exists, does that make it easier? Does it make it harder? Is it... are there different challenges?
I would say...
It's just different.
It's different. Yeah. Normally you've got a take on the characters, because the characters... If you're writing, let's say you're writing Iron Man or any of the X-Men, these are big characters that have been around for generations.
Yes.
And different writers have their own take on them. So you try to find a take. Generally speaking, I think when you start writing a character, you sound like you're doing a bad impression. As in, not even can necessarily tell. But you, like when I started writing Loki, I was very much writing on a surface level, and then I dug into him, and then I ended up basically being my favourite character in Marvel and writing enormous epics about the dude.
Sure.
So that's the thing. It is on one level easy, because if the worst comes to the worst, I'm writing Wolverine, you go schnicked bub, and you get paid for it.
Some aspects make it harder. Yeah, that's why it's both easier and harder. Some aspects make it easier, some aspects make it harder. And so it kind of balances out. It's just different.
So when I first started writing Wolverine, I was kind of aware that, have I got anything to say about this character? Because there's been so many.
That's
the flip.
Yeah. He's been travelled over so many times.
Yeah. But also that also kind of makes it easier, because as Kieron says, if you're short on inspiration, you know what you can do to make the character sound like the character, because you know so many people have come before you.
Okay. Cool. Another question. Yes, sir. There's a mic running towards you over here, sir. You look very professional in that hat. I like it.
Run, man in the hat.
Go for
run.
It.
How important do you think story is to gameplay? So for example, there are games like like Dwarf Fortress or lots and lots of games that don't have any story, and then the players create their own stories. And for you, Mike, did you consider, let's not have any story, and then let's just have a pure platformer and let the gamers create their own story? And for you guys, being in the story industry, where kind of maybe, there's an element of you want to bring that into gaming. But how important do you think it is?
I would disagree about Dwarf Fortress not having a story. In a real way, story in games is about motivation. Dwarf Fortress has a world. All the story is the universe. Mm. In other words, all the mechanics that's been built into it is the story. And it's not like you end up with this. Dwarf Fortress creates a place.
And it's like Space Invaders. Yeah, yeah. It's called Dwarf Fortress.
Yeah.
You know?
Well, I know. I don't think a traditional narrative story is necessary. I think many of my favourite games are very much about the setting. The stories which are about the setting, the stories about being a sense of place. Yeah. And the idea that we are just, the Hollywood blockbuster story is not the only story that exists. Yeah. So I think for a writer, I could bring lots of things to a different sorts of games, which does not require having a big cutscene of, people with good hair. You don't need that.
Perhaps unusually for a writer who works a lot in games, I actually don't think that writing is the most important thing about games. Mm-hmm. Gameplay is paramount in all games, no question. Otherwise, you are just, reading a story or watching a story or watching a movie. But good writing, whether it's world building or whether it is an actual traditional narrative, can elevate a game. So if you have a good game, then a good story combined with good gameplay can make it a great game. What it can't do is, a story can never make a game that is fun to play worse.
Unless it gets
Just
in the
Cause
way.
2, they tried.
Right. But I mean, seriously, look at, there are lots of games, older games especially, with terrible stories, but because they had great gameplay, they're still fondly remembered. You can't drag the gameplay down, but you can elevate it with a good story, or good narrative, I should say. Stories are a bad term to use with games. I always say narrative, because world building is part of narrative, even if you're not telling a traditional story. Just creating the world for the game to take place in can really enhance and elevate.
I mean,
really
minor and little piece of evocative. I always talk about video games. It's just the abyss of an evocative phrase that, I said Space Invaders is the one I always use, but what's on the start of R-Type? Is it blast off and strike the evil Bido Empire?
It's that great. Kind of, yeah.
So today, fuck you, Bido Empire. I'm coming at you. Yeah. That contextualization I love.
I think
Spelunky. The three random lines at the start of Spelunky. That is beautiful.
It's a lovely idea. I think that's the thing from a game design point of view. This is a debate that comes up a lot. It's the kind of, is player story versus game story. So game story, Mario is looking to save his princess. Player story is, as you said, is I jumped over that thing and had a good time. I think the two should be treated as separate things, and what's interesting is what you decide to do at the intersection. So with Thomas, it was very much, I'm going to try really hard not to say, the Fremdung's effect is the Brechtian kind of stuff of having a cat. so I'm not going to go there. But the idea of having an intentional alienation, and actually therefore finding characters through that. And also the characters do support, there's no dissonance between what you do as, hopefully, what you do as the character is also tied into the actual, the character. So a character who is angry because he can't jump very high, therefore he can't jump very high. It's not like Metal Gear Solid, where in the cutscenes, Snake is far cooler than he is when I'm controlling him. It was
Snake, don't run into a wall.
Yeah. Exactly. It's, I think that works, but it has to be done knowingly. And I think arguably in the Metal Gear Solid series, I think it is actually done knowingly. I think a lot of like the kind of anti-nuclear proliferation stuff in MGS1 versus what you're doing in the game is of snapping people's necks, I think that's totally on purpose. I think they're intentionally playing with your what you do in games. But I think it's about knowing, right? It's just about knowing that this exists, that there are kind of two stories being told in tandem, and then deciding what you do with that intersection.
There's complicated effects you can do, like, you know, that Metal Gear Solid, I'm not the biggest fan in the world, but I would agree, you know, this is clearly it's trying to communicate something by the juxtaposition. I mean, but on the most basic level for me, story is about motivation. And that it's the reason Boiling Point as a game had many flaws, and I love them all, like flying jaguars and whatever. But the very basic idea of Boiling Point being, your daughter is lost somewhere in this enormous open world, find her. At least you always, and all the kind of missions you're doing along the way is because I'm doing this to get that. And for me, game narratives falls apart when literally I have no idea why I'm shooting this dude.
It's right. The 90s.
And generally, when people start overcomplicating stories in like, all writing in wankly, the last Call of Duty I played was always like, I have literally no idea why I have no idea why I'm shooting you.
Yeah.
And except, you know, they do the cutover voices and the most pretentious purple proseness. And it's like, just tell us the fucking story. You know,
if you remove motivation and context from games, then you basically may as well just be like, tap this button when a colour flashes on the screen. You're at that level of interaction, and that's not engaging. That's, you know, what context, narrative, and motivation brings.
Yeah, this is my Space Invaders example. Exactly. It's like, you know, once everybody from space, stop them. You know, that gives me a reason.
Well, I've mentioned 1930s German theatre, so I'll also mention Transformers.
The two poles.
Like
of
this is what, but this is what Transformers did. Like, because Transformers was, I was geeking out about this the other day. Transformers is a puzzle game in Japan. It's you don't get instructions. You get a transformer, and you have to transform. It's like a Rubik's cube. When they brought it to America, because of how well Star Wars action figures did, they added this whole Autobots versus Decepticons, Long War, Evil on both. Yeah, it's exactly what good game stories do. Is it gives kids the tools with which to tell their own stories and to have their own experience.
Yeah.
So I think that's cool.
I love reading the Dotter character histories. As in, it's like, are you sure this character did this 800 paragraphs of nonsense? I'm not sure. I think he's existed. What I want to know about Dotter is why did these people build the two castles so near each other?
Mm.
That's going to cause problems.
Indeed.
It's like, you know, they didn't think it through at all.
Indeed.
Dotter or Dota?
I don't know.
I've always said Dota.
Next question. Anyone? Yes.
Chap there.
Good afternoon. Do you have any advice on the Do you have any advice on or pitfalls to avoid when trying to tie together open world games?
Keep it loose. It's all a matter of sort of practice and experience again. Open world games are difficult, and it comes down to knowing how to create a narrative that is loose but hangs together. And can be approached from lots of different angles, so that no matter what order the player might do something in, it seems it's smoke and mirrors. Mm. Basically, open world narratives are smoke and mirrors more so than most. Now, I mean, all narratives are really, but open world games really are smoke and mirrors. I draw the comparison in a little under an hour in the other venue, the Old Council. I'm doing a talk about writing for comics and games, and one of the comparisons I make is, it used to be quite common in comics to do single issues, like standalone stories. And they were often written by different people at the same time with no knowledge of what the other people were working on. But they featured the same characters and they all had to hang together. And it's the same kind of very loose continuity that you use the reader's imagination and people's tendency to see stories and patterns and connections where actually you haven't designed any. You use that to your advantage and make people think that there is something a bit stronger and deeper there than there actually is. If any of you have ever run tabletop role-playing games, you'll probably know what I'm talking about. When you come up with a scenario and your players pick up on something that you had not intended and run with it, and you're like, wow, and suddenly they think that your game is much deeper than it actually is. It's the same kind of, like I say, smoke and mirrors.
which is all games are.
And all
magic,
writing,
magic trick. I thought was fantastic.
It's always the magic trick. You know, what's up your sleeve? Yeah. The entire universe.
Yeah. Very cool. I know a lot of open world games, of course, are kind of just linear anyway, right? They're actually leading you between. You've always got like two missions.
You've got choke points.
Yeah, it's very. It feels like often they're.
It's objective based, really. They choose the objective, and
you
then
can do
if
these
the dude
five
dies,
missions.
Okay.
You
order.
Just make the line like that instead of like that.
Right.
Cool. Next question, and also the person who just tweeted Danny Wallace personally to tell him I do an impression. I have a very particular set of skills, and I will find you. Oh, there's one here. So thank you, whoever that was. Sorry. I'm going to get an email. I'm going to have to do it down the phone to him.
I'm just wondering what you guys think of elements of failure in narrative, in game narrative, like if the character like dies or fails to complete their objective when it's a player that you control. Because obviously it's got the element of unexpected, which you said is a good thing, but it's just really annoying because, and also on second playthrough as well, it removes the element of motivation because you know you're just going towards this inevitable failure.
I'm sorry, I'm not.
You're talking about forced failure, as in the
idea. Yeah, exactly.
The bit where you walk into a room and all your weapons are taken off.
So the classic example is Deus Ex does it. In
I hate
a couple
that.
Of places.
Yeah. I'm not a fan of forced failure at all. Yeah. It's
not in a game that's about winning. It's like the cruelest thing you can do.
Yeah. Well, I'm not a big fan because it feels cheap.
Mm.
You know, it's a bit like in a comic or a novel or something. It's a bit like killing off the beloved sidekick or something just to make people to make something seem more profound than it is. And just to make people go, oh, shocking. It's cheap.
On the other hand, it's probably a design thing, really. That's very much. Mm. I don't think many writers deliberately choose. Maybe they do actually.
No, I think a lot of designers who want to be writers choose to do it. Yeah. I think that's like you say, it's a very easy way of, and it's that pathos, and that's something really I tried with Thomas. Was I get frustrated in indie games that pathos is the default. Like, to me, I want to like a character before I feel bad about them. And that was kind of a lot of Thomas's humour came
you've
from.
You've got to earn those moments. Mm. That's the thing. It's not, I wouldn't say that it's never valid to do it, but you've got to earn a moment like that. And a lot of the time, especially in games, it's not.
Have you played Planescape Torment?
No.
Right. without spoiling it, Planescape has a downer ending. And the downer ending of games, and it is kind of like the whole game is a failure. And it's an incredibly poetic and beautiful ending.
Yeah.
So point being, it's possible to make a failure work. Yeah. I just think it's hard.
Well, I think it's if your character makes the failure is a big part of it. Is if it's your character behaves in a way that you weren't expecting, or they betray you. That's I think the ones that really frustrate seem to be those ones. So I don't know what the ending to that game is, but it's. Is it that your character does something awful, or is it just that it's outside
of the
context?
It's kind of it's the bullshit as a new. It's like you said the opposite. MGS, the character, Snake's much more competent, but it's always as I said. So what you walk cutscene, your character walks into the room, gets hit on the back of the head, and it's like bullshit. My healing would have healed me back in a second. Hit on the back of the head.
Right,
it's like the I always remember like Vampire, the first Vampire, not Bloodlines,
not
Redemption.
Mass.
It was like Diablo slasher, and the whole plot is about your wife, I think. It's like, oh, she's really ill, she's sick, and we've got to go to the bottom of a dungeon and get a herb or some bullshit. And like, the second you leave the house, there's like, the next door is like a shop, this stock full of healing potions. And it's like, that story just does not work due to the mechanics in the game. And so false failure, when you're playing basically a superhuman character, makes no sense. It just breaks the game because you do not buy that. And there's ways to make, there are surely ways to do it. But Deus Ex did, but it hid its false failure quite well, It's not like it happened in a cutscene.
Oh,
it gave you an impossible battle.
Well, and that's what I mean about you've got to earn it. As long as it's presented as something that... How can I put it? Presented as something that fits the story the character is going through and doesn't just make you think, well, hang on, if I just did that, this would never happen. Because that's the problem with a lot of forced failure, isn't it? You think, well, hang on, what if I just don't walk into that room? If you can avoid that, and present it as something that just is sort of logical and makes sense within the journey the character's going through, then you can pull it off. But it is tricky. It is very tricky.
I think the shift as well on giving players agency at those big moments, it's become very fashionable to have the moment where the player has to walk into the ending And when that's, I'm thinking specifically of Mass Effect 3.
Laughing.
Yeah, it's like that's where it almost heightens that problem because you're forced to fail.
Yeah.
Literally, as a player. Right, it's not just watching someone else fail, you're actually pushed into that line. So, yeah.
Although at least, you know, to their credit, at least the one thing Mass Effect 3 did do was give you a choice to not make a choice.
Yeah.
Which a lot of games don't do.
I actually quite like the Mass Effect. I actually got into a lot of shouting matches on Twitter because I quite liked the ending. I thought as an ending to an 80s sci-fi movie, I liked it. As an ending to that game series, I felt there were flaws, but yes.
Like I said, endings are fucking hard.
Yes. Yeah.
They really are. Sorry.
Especially if you've had three games, I suppose.
Yeah.
Next question. Ah, yes. We got over here, sir. You're getting quite the workout today.
Yeah.
Fellow with the magnificent sideburns.
Yes, we admire.
They are pretty impressive. Yeah.
They are very impressive.
Heroic.
Nice sideburns are back in a big
it's
way.
True. Yeah,
yeah. It is mainly Phil Fish's fault, I think. I think it's created the fashion.
Great Hello. Face texture work.
Did you get sideburns because Phil Fish has awesome sideburns?
No, I found out about them afterwards. Oh, no.
We're wearing the same thing.
I'm so embarrassed.
Question about writing. Is it possible to write for all age groups?
What do you mean?
Yes, but it's hard.
I mean, any advice or tips on that? Or
no swearing.
Do a story to actually appeal to everybody.
It is really difficult. I mean, Pixar obviously are sort of past masters of this.
It's the difference between a kid's game and a family's game. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, that, you know, and kids' narrative by definition is not really made for adults. It's frankly too annoying. Whilst a family thing, yeah, that's kind of what you're talking about. And Pixar the masters.
Yeah, it
Disney
tough.
When they were good, the best.
In terms of advice, don't make it too simple. Kids are smarter than you think and will understand more in narrative terms than you think. On the other hand, don't put too many nods and winks to the adults because, you know, then suddenly it won't be just for the kids.
It devalues it, right? When you see a film that has like a reference to The Exorcist every 10 minutes, there's a lot of these kind of children's movies that are there with all those. I think it actually degrades the quality of the experience.
Yeah, exactly.
It's a lack of faith in your own fictional universe, and I think that it's impossible to. It is possible to do stories that work on multiple levels. It's just like, you know.
The success of YA fiction over the last 10, 12 years since Harry Potter, more than 12 years, what am I saying?
Mm.
Shows, you know, adults are quite happy to read. And so to engage with fiction, read, watch, listen, whatever, to engage with stories that are aimed at younger people. You don't have to think, oh, the adults won't like this, I'd better throw in, a gratuitous, you know, Exorcist reference or something. Don't fall into that trap. But at the same time, don't dumb it down so much that even kids are like, oh, it's boring.
I love Coraline because that feels like a film that absolutely is written respecting kids to get it, to be okay with being scared. It feels like that's the kind of...
That was another thing I was going to say, was emotionally don't underestimate kids as well.
Mm.
Kids can handle jeopardy and being scared and, you know, complex emotions and stuff.
And enjoy it as
much better
as the rest
than most adults would like to think they can.
Yeah. this isn't quite the same thing, but writing for kids, as especially like early teenagers... was the idea that a lot of parents have the idea what kids' books should be, and that's very different from what kids' books should be. And especially when doing comics, you're trying to make stuff that exists on the meniscus of... thank you. So stuff which is offensive enough to actually fill my 11-year-old self, but isn't offensive enough to stop the actual parents buying it.
Right. Yeah,
That kind of very thin line of excitement. Yeah. That's why... it was always easy as a young teenager to read novels because your parents would never actually read the novels, therefore they would never know exactly how horrific this Ian M. Banks book was.
Mm.
Whereas
you would get disapproving glances for buying 2000 AD.
Yes.
Which I did. and they would see some...
But they put it right on the
horrendous
cover.
Horrendous piece of ultraviolence on the cover.
Which is, presumably, that's why you bought it.
Hell yes. Yeah, exactly. That's what appealed.
Okay, so one more question, I think, before we... Go on then.
Yes, one more.
I'm impressed by that's fantastic. The ducking under the camera. Sorry, please.
Yeah, just a question about like characters in narrative. There are a lot of games these days which seem to take like blank characters with like no personality, and then they want the player to like put their own feelings while playing the game on that character. But then you've got characters that sort of have a basic blank personality but still have their own goals and own meanings and all wanting to complete their storyline. Which one do you think's like preferred and sort of is a better in game design these days? Because they're still very both about, but it's very rare to see someone actually say, oh, that one's better, that one's easier, that one's more empowering, that one makes the player feel better. I'm just wondering what you guys would say would be a better way to present a character within a story.
I'm struggling to think of. Sorry, can you be more specific? I'm struggling.
Well, it's
to think
like it's
the
like
blank
when you,
characters.
When
you
play an RPG,
you mean
you like no character,
like Gordon Freeman,
no personality
basically.
At all. Like Gordon Freeman
kind of
in Half-Life, he has no.
You're talking about protagonists,
yeah,
not NPCs,
yeah.
Right? I personally prefer a protagonist with a personality. I prefer, I don't like the silent protagonist that you kind of supposedly project yourself into. Because as soon as you give a character a name, you're giving them a personality. Mm. You've immediately gendered them. You've, given them a sort of a role, and they're clearly going on some kind of journey that you're taking them through. So I think it's a bit of a... I don't think there is such a thing as a completely blank character, unless you are, it is something like, I don't know, Quake 3. Where there really is just no personality. But even then, they're gendered.
Yeah.
You can still...
And they've got big spikes on their shoulders and they've
right,
got
Right, yeah, there's
a
still
look.
Some kind of personality.
Yeah.
So I think it's a mistake to think that you can have a completely blank character in that sort of situation. So yeah, I would always prefer... Actually, when I'm playing Uncharted, I like the fact that I'm playing Nathan Drake. Mm. I wouldn't want to play some faceless guy called Nathan Drake who has no personality and never speaks. That would be boring in that kind of game. Conversely, when I'm playing something like Quake or whatever, I don't care. And actually, I would have been much happier in something like Quake 3 if there were no character models whatsoever. Because
like rectangles or something.
Right, well, because it felt like... I'm thinking specifically of Quake 3 because that was the first Quake which was pure multiplayer, pure battle map and no narrative. And it felt like they were trying to sort of... give you a narrative without actually giving you a narrative. Mm. They were trying to imply one, and it just felt cheap.
I think you're right. I think the Half-Life protagonist being Gordon Freeman. I think Gordon Freeman isn't the protagonist of Half-Life. I think all Half-Life 2. I think he's the cameraman. I think the protagonist is the environment.
The player character.
Yeah, I think too much of. I didn't embody Gordon Freeman. He was still. A scientist feeling guilty for accidentally causing the destruction of the world.
Immersion, despite the fact that he has no personality.
Yeah, I was told that story by the world. I think it just externalized it from him a bit. Yeah.
I think both can be executed well. Mm. Half-Life works, no matter what you say about it. I think the one thing which is a mistake is to give you a character and underwrite them because you think that the blanker the character is, the more you empathise with. That's my main...
Right,
one of my reservations for the first Deus Ex, that JC Denton's really fucking boring. Mm. He's like just boring to be. He's not... he's just not an interesting dude.
It was a problem with the
will he choose a sniper rifle or a rocket launcher?
Deus Ex is one of my favourite games ever, but the Mass Effect is one of the interesting that, Shepard has a voice. I play a female Shepard, and there's only female Shepards. there's Femtrap. Whether you go Renegade or Paragon, she's identifiably her.
Yeah. And
that's good. That's a really... They walked a very fine and beautiful line there. Mm.
This is one of the problems we had on Dead Space. I wanted Isaac Clarke to speak in the first Dead Space game. And the argument was, no. If we have a silent protagonist, people will identify more. And actually, all we got was lots and lots of people complaining that he never spoke. Mm. And we had to come up with really convoluted dialogue of people talking at him and answering their own questions because he didn't speak. And they learned their lesson, and I didn't write Dead Space 2, but when they came to do Dead Space 2, they did give him a voice, because they'd realised that it just hadn't kind of made sense.
Well, the first thing he cleared his throat. Now I feel better.
Take he a opens up a mouth hole on the visor.
Yeah. You can turn the volume up on this.
Yeah. I've been muted the whole time.
Yeah.
Because that's it. It's like the Skype conversations. Okay, wow, I think that's all we've got time for, unfortunately. I'd like to thank the guys. It's been absolutely fantastic having you. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Just to... Yes, I've got a few bits of housekeeping. so apologies, I'll rattle through it. 4:30 is the last capsule session happening, Capsule, which is apparently awesome. I've not had a chance yet. And then also there's the party on Segen. I think you sign up in the tent, and then it's over. I want to say, where? Sorry. Oh, it's here.
Right.
You get taken here, so you go back to the tent, then you come back here. Brilliant. So do that. And then sorry. And then also there's a big party on Saturday. Tickets are £5, and they are available outside in Antenna. And I think that's it.
Can I just give a couple of quick plugs? If anybody wants to listen to me yammer on for another hour in 35 minutes at the Town Council venue, I'll be doing that talk about writing for comics and games. And then also at 4:30 today, Ed Stern, who is the lead writer of Splash Damage, the developers of Brink and many other games, is also giving a talk at 4:30, also in the old Council Hall. And Ed is a great guy and a great speaker, so that I would highly recommend that.
Yes.
And
yes.
We're doing.
Oh, and we're signing at page 45 at 5 o'clock.
Yes, for until 6:30. So
very cool.
Buy comics.
Yeah, yeah. But yeah, that goes on to 6:30. So if you want to go to Edge things, stay till 5:30, and then it's page 45 is opposite Debenhams, literally just around the corner on Market Street. Yeah.
Best comic book shop in the world.
We'll still be there. Yep. Absolutely.
Cool. Awesome. Thank you very much. Thanks everyone for listening as well.